examples is the first smooth one, which is the Bovril Denali vacuum cubics. I'm going to say this very briefly. I just want to get one point across. Okay, so you consider P14 here to be the two forms on C6. And then you look at the two forms which have low rank. They only have, so think of two forms as a skew symmetric matrix. So they'll have generically rank 6. Look at the guys at rank 4 or less. They will have even rank. That's the so-called Fatim variety inside P14. Intersect that with a generic P5. That's where the cubic fourfolds live. This is a cubic hypersurface, this Fatim here. And you get a cubic fourfold. Now, take projective duals. So, in the space of hyperplanes, in this projective space, take the hyperplanes which are tangent to this vacuum. That's this Grassmannian. Intersect that's no longer a hypersurface. That's got some high codimension. Intersect that with a P8, with the annihilator of this P5, so the dual P8. And that gives you a surface, and it's a case of surface. So this gives you some kind of correspondence between X and S. And you know, you can see there's vacuums and Grassmannians. These things naturally carry bundles. There's a natural correspondence between these. It's really more like a vector bundle or something. And that gives a correspondence between X and S and gives you this map of cohomologies, which says that indeed cohomologically X looks like it, otherwise it's a surface. And indeed, Bovril and Denali show that all these guys are rational, but I'm not going to go into that. But what I want to get across is there's some other ad hoc constructions. It's not general in any sense. It depends on the geometry in this case. And you just have to pull it out of the air in each case. Okay, so there's no general way of getting this K3 surface. And also, this K3 surface isn't just some surface in your cubic or something. There's some weird, complicated correspondence. It may not even be using cycles. It might be using vector bundles. So, of course, what you should think of is Fourier-McKay codimensions instead. But I come back to that. I mean, what this is supposed to indicate to you is what should really be going on is that S should be some moduli space of sheaves on X. That's what unifies all these different examples I'll give you. So now I'll give you an example where that's true. So this is a non-example. D equals 8 is not on my list. Pass it to list here. D equals 8 is divisible by 4. So this isn't on the list. But there'll be kind of a K3 surface in this case, and this case will be very useful for all other cases later. So this is an important one to understand. So this is cubics containing a plane. So that's my extra class here, is the homology class of the plane. Indeed, the discriminant of this rank 2 lattice expands is 8. So the intersection matrix is 3, 1, 1, 3. Okay, so how do we get a K3 surface here? This is quite another classical construction. So I have this plane, this P2, inside P5, which lies in the cubic. Now I'm going to form another P2, so I call this one P and this one P2. And what's this P2? This is the space of P3s, linear, three-dimensional sections of P5, which contain the plane. Okay, so you check that's a P2. Now, such a linear P3 in P5 intersects X in a cubic surface. But it contains the plane, so this cubic surface is a quadric surface in the plane. So what I have now is a P2 family of quadric surfaces. Okay, so really what that gives me is when you work it out, you blow up the plane, you blow up X in the plane, and the slide is over P2 with quadric. This is my P2 family of quadric surfaces. Okay, so X blown up in there. Plane is a quadric surface vibration of P2. And you know, quadric surface generically is P1 plus P1. This is getting close to looking rational, but not quite. So the fibers are all rational, and the base is rational. But you need a section of this to project. I'll come to it in a second. But you need a section of this vibration to make it rational. So this isn't quite rational. And indeed, that's because D isn't on my list. Let me K3 of itself. K3 with a double cover of this. So the discriminant locus, in fact, it's here, look, there's a K3 locus. So the discriminant locus where this vibration has singularities is a sexy curve. general fibre over P2, and then you have these special fibres with only one rule. So there's a code over a point curve, and this is over the sextic. So there's naturally associated to this, this moduli space, you could consider the lines in the quadratic surface fibers of this fibration. So there's, you know, it's a disjoint, it's, in this case, it's here the moduli space, well it's over P2, but here the fiber is just P1 disjoint union of P1. Right, there's this P1 lines and this P1. And then over here, the fiber.
So is it really white? It's a bit invisible.
Sorry?
If you use white tool, it's a bit invisible.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Run that again. So I have this moduli space over my P2, right, which is generically, there's two disjoint P1s, and then those collapse into one P1 over the discriminant. And so, you know, that defines a double cover of P2 branch over the sextic. Okay? So the double cover is where I pick a choice of a ruling. So I don't separate, I don't consider all these lines in one ruling to be different. P1, I consider them to all be the same. So if I choose a ruling, I have two choices of ruling generically, and only one choice of a branch like this. So this choice of ruling gives me a double cover of P2, and that's my P2 surface. Okay? So I naturally have a P1 model over that, M is naturally a P1 model. Okay? And then this isn't quite a K3 surface, because really it's a K3 surface of the Brouwer class. So this P1 model over the K3 surface may or may not be the projectivization of a vector model, a rank 2 vector model. And the Brouwer class is the instruction to that. So there's many ways of seeing that. Either you can try and find it. So getting this P1 model to be the projectivization of a vector model is equivalent to finding an O1 on each fiber gluing together to give me a line model on the whole thing. Okay, so locally I can find an O1 line model on each fiber, but then when I try to glue them together, I get a co-cycle, and the co-cycle obviously lies in there, and that's the Brouwer class. Or I guess for this conference you're supposed to call it the Jurth or something. And then, but it's also the instruction to find this vector model that would just be pushed down by O1 or its dual. And it's also the instruction to finding a rational section of this P1 model. If you can find a section generically that gives you a divisor and that gives you a line model, and that line model is O1 on each fiber. So what we really get is a K3 surface and this Brouwer class. And generically, because D is not on the list, you find that the K3 surface, the cohomology does not sit inside. I've set up a natural correspondence, but it does not sit the cohomology naturally inside the cohomology of the qubit unless you invert 2 or something. I think there's some problem with cards. But when you get an extra class, so you know, I'm on this locus of qubits with a plane where there's integral 2-2 classes of form a rank 2 lattice, I could move it in that divisor to something, a further co-dimension, and find a lattice of rank 3. So will I get an extra class? So in that case, if this extra class integrates over these fibers to give you 1, which is the same thing as integrating to give you an odd number, because you've already got an h squared, that integrates to give you 2. Anyway, so if you get an odd number when you integrate this over the fibers, if this number is odd or 1, then the Brouwer class is zero. Okay? As you can see, the Poincaré dual of this is something like a section. It's not really. But you move to that N moduli space, you push and pull, this class becomes a divisor roughly speaking, this condition you should think of as saying that the brow plus vanishes, or that the original quadric surface bubble has a section, or that moduli space I introduced has a section. Now, the moment you have a section, that means that you get, see, a quadric. How do you make a quadric isomorphic to P2? You just pick a point in the quadric. And now you take lines through that point, that's a P2. And where do they intersect the quadric? They intersect in one more point, because they only intersect in two points. And so that gives you your map to P2. But to do that, so that's stereographic projection. To do that, I need to pick a point. Now, I have a family of those guys, so in other words, I need to pick a section. So to get this quadric bundle over P2 to be rational, I need a section. And then by stereographic projection, I find it rational. So I find that all these conditions are the same, that the Brouwer class vanishes, or that I have this condition, this third class, this rank 3 lattice, or that it's rational. Okay? And in that case, I really have a K3. Okay, back then. Okay, so in that case, I can show actually by tweaking this T prime class, so I can find a T which has discriminant which is on my list, my scala. So in this case, where I have an extra class, the reason why everything becomes rational when I get a K3 surface and so on is not because I'm on this locus where the degree is 8. It's because I'm intersected with one of the loci on my list, on this scala list. Okay? So I was on this NL8 locus where the cubic contained the plane, and I really wasn't on my scala list. But what I've done is I've passed to this even smaller locus, co-dimension 2 locus, where I have an extra class. And that's really what's making me rational and kind of K3 surface. So I want to draw that picture because it's going to be important later. So what colours are working? Blue?
Orange? White?
No, I'm going to use white, but I need one more. you know, say from O to itself, you get, in this case, 6 ohms here and 6 ohms here, but why not? But this is what's called an exceptional collection. It means there's no arrows back, and the arrows at the vertices are just as small as possible, there's only one. And because of that, you can kind of use a Gram-Schmidt process to project orthogonally to this. You can talk about the orthogonal to this, and the whole thing spans. So you can take any object and write it as some combination of these. So it's kind of inner product with these times a bunch of these, plus something orthogonal to these, which is this AX. So I replace E by its inner product with O, that's with O, evaluated to E. This thing's now orthogonal to O, then I do it with O1 and O2, and I can get right back into here. So I have this category, which is embedded in DX, and I can project that. Okay. So this is Kuznetsov's category, AX. And it looks like a K3, so it's a two-dimensional Clavier category. Its Hochschild cohomology looks like that of a K3. Presumably there's a mirror physics explanation for this. The LG model has 4 singular fibers, so 3 points. That's just these 3. You know, their X groups look like the structure sheet of a point in 0 dimensions, so inside the point, not in a Clavier 3. So it looks like 3 points. And another fiber with a singular set of K3 surface, which is presumably mirror to this non-conducive K3. That's not something I understand. Okay, and so the existence of this category, which is supposed to pretend is a K3, kind of explains the Boveel-Dinagi amazing holomorphic structure on the Fano of lines in X. So this Fano parametrizing lines in X, which is 4-dimensional, is really a moduli space of objects in this category, and so it has a Mukai symplectic structure. So because it's really a moduli space in K3 surface. So it gets the holomorphic symplectic structure from the kind of holomorphic symplectic structure on here. In other words, or a choice of two points. So in other words, the trivialization of the stem. And we call AX geometric if and only if it really is a derived category of a genuine K3 surface. And Kuznetsov conjectures, because of all these examples and more besides, that X is rational if and only if AX is geometric. And again, the idea is, at some point, this rational maps in the block of K3 surface introduce the derived category of K3 into the derived category of Q. All right, so again, this D equals A, which is the important bit. I have this picture. And S, the K3 surface, parameterizes certain sheaves on X. So roughly speaking, you know, a point in X, that was a choice of ruling. Pick one of the lines in the ruling, take its ideal sheaf on the surface. Doesn't matter which one I take, they all define me the same line level on the surface. Push it forward. So S is now parameterizing certain sheaves on X. And in fact, it's a moduli space of objects in this AX. So I now project to this AX. So this K3 surface is really a moduli space of objects. And that's what I wanted to know. And then the universal object on S times X, there isn't a universal sheaf, because when you try to glue it all together and get a universal sheaf, you precisely get a co-cycle. So it exists locally, but there's some co-cycle to define it globally, and that's this Brouwer class that I mentioned before. So you end up with a twisted sheaf, or a twisted complex of sheaves on S times X. If you use that as a Fourier-Mackay transform instead of a correspondence, then you find, because Kuznetsov proves that this AX is precisely the derived category of coherent sheaves on S twisted by this geometric pattern. And so X is geometric precisely when you alpha is 0, so when you intersect with one of these other devices. So the picture you should have is that this is meant to look like K3 moduli space. But K3 moduli space, you have all these devices, but you have this big open, you have this big other locus, and that's the analytic K3. In this picture, that's not what you have. You have the same sort of picture, but this big green locus is the locus of non-commutative K3. So you've got this one extra direction, which is like some combination of a Jervy direction and a Poisson direction. So it's not all of them, so it's not all non-commutative K3s, it's co-dimensional one. But you never see any analytic K3s because you're sort of in algebra geometry line. So it's a similar thing. Okay, so what we do, we're trying to show that these two conjectures are the same, so we're trying to show that you're on the list, so you're homologically K3 if and only if you're derived categorically K3. So how do we do this? Oh my god, I've got 5 minutes, okay. So what we do is we say if you're on the list, that's some condition on the cohomology. We translate that into some condition on the K-theory. There's some hideous lattice nonsense. And you show that being on the list, this is really the explanation about this, is that it's the same as having two classes in the K-theory, this AX, which satisfy the following things. One looks like kind of like a point and one looks like a line. So you're supposed to think of, you know, in the case where this AX is really the derived category of the K3 surface, in the K-theory of the K3 surface, there are two obvious points, two obvious objects, the structure sheet of a point and the trivial line on the line surface. Okay? And two points don't intersect because you move them apart, so you get this. And a line and a point intersect in one point, so you get this. And a line is spherical, so you get this. Okay? So anyway, so there's just some lattice theory computation which says you're on that list if and only if you have a point-like object and a line-like object in K3. It's topological. And so of course that's what's going on here, is that what you want to say is this A is really comes from an object of the derived category, and its moduli space is going to be the K3 surface. So it's like AX contains points. It's like this category contains points. And then what the line is there for is to make the universal sheaf fine, rather than a twisted sheaf. So what you find on this NL8 is you also contain points, but you don't contain the line. Okay? Then we show that this all the NLTs that we're interested in intersect NL8. So that's this picture I drew here, that's vital. Because we understand NLA rather well, and we're going to do deformation theory away from NLA. So I don't understand NL38, but what I do is I move to this intersection point, work things out there, and then try and deform that guy. Now, because I'm at this intersection point, I can now use Kuznetsov and work on NL8, and my alpha will be zero, and I really get a derived equivalent. So I really find AX is geometric. But I have completely the wrong derived equivalence. This is using the wrong point-like object. So the class A in here is not the class of a point in here. This is the wrong equivalence. This will not deform away from NL8 into NL30. But it's okay because I really have this equivalence. So I'm really, instead of working in some abstract category, I'm now working in the derived category of K3 surface. Whenever you're working in K3 surfaces, you have Mukai. Mukai does everything for you. So now Mukai shows that in my class A, remember here I have this class A, I translate that over, that's in the K-theory of this derived category. It's not the class of a point, because I'm using the wrong equivalence, but it is the class of something that I can form a moduli space of. So there is a two-dimensional moduli space, in fact another K3, but she's on S of class A, so Mukai gives me that. That's what I don't have for the general AX. I don't have Mukai for all these non-commutative figures. I only have Mukai for the commutative figures. And so now, that gives me the right equivalent. So now I have a point here that goes to the sheaf, point-like sheaf that was the wrong one on S, and then that goes to AX. So this moduli space, I use it to set up these equivalences, and now this is the right equivalence. So my AX, I shouldn't compare to dB of S, I should compare it to dB of this moduli. Now I'm going to deform. Now I've got the right equivalence, so I'm going to deform off. Right? And so as I said, I already explained the intuition. The intuition is I have these classes A and B. So I should be able to form moduli spaces of objects of type A and B, which is stable or something, and get my equivalent. Because we don't know enough about forming moduli spaces. Now as I move away, I'm deforming my qubit. I then deform my K3 by abstract to relative. So because I'm on this locus, HACCP tells me my K3, my cohomology of my qubit still looks like the cohomology of K3, so I abstract and get a deformation of my K3 n. And so I now have a deformation of my space over here. And what I want to do is show that the universal object over n times x, this complex of sheaves, deforms as well. And what we prove is it deforms to all orders, and therefore by algebra S, it really deforms over as a risky open. And all these guys, by the way, these NL8s and 38s and so forth, they're all irreducible. Okay, so we get that Kuznetsov implies HACCP, that's some lattice theory, and HACCP implies Kuznetsov up to passing to some Zariski, something that contains a Zariski open, something dense. Okay, so we can convene it. And then this deformation theory I extend with, that's inspired by work of Toner, Hoogrest, Macri, and Stellari, but we do it slightly differently, it's a slightly different situation. They're interested in deforming kernels over a K3 times K3. We're interested in deforming over to a K3 times substitute for a K3. So we have to work a little differently. But roughly speaking, so that's the end of the talk, but I just try and give you some idea here. So so we have this universal object on sort of my M, that's my K3 times X, but really it's taking the drive category of M into AX, so let me put AX in. That doesn't quite make sense as a category in other space, but anyway. And then as I deform these guys, I want to know, can I deform this? The obstruction lies in here. Okay, in the derived category of the product. But then the derived category of these are the same. So under that correspondence, I can sort of replace this by n by n. N times n, these have the same derived category. And under that correspondence, this becomes the diagonal. It becomes the identity function. So u is what takes n to ax. If I identify ax with n, topologically, I'm taking m to n by the identity. So this is isomorphic to this. And then what's this? You just compute it, it's just a cohomology. This is just H2 of the K3 surface. So that's the connection between the categories and the cohomology. And then you identify, so what is the obstruction? It's something that lies in there. Work out what it is. It's the following. It's the deformation of m that you're taking. That lies in here. The entire Spencer class lies in H1TM, but M's a K3 surface, so by the holomorphic reflexive structure, it lies in H1 of omega M. You get a class in there, that's the deformation of M. And then you also get, you have a deformation of X, which under the correspondence, the cohomology of X to the cohomology of M, corresponds to a class in here as well. And so you work out what this obstruction class is, and it's the difference. And by definition, these two are the same. I chose my deformation of M to match the deformation of X in the derelict. So these are the same. So I get zero. And then you have to do that for all. Okay, thank you very much. It's not the whole thing. So I can only prove it on a be open. So just on some damp slopes, but I can't prove it yet everywhere. So if you try and take a closure, you really need to know something about stability conditions or something. We have lots of clever ways of taking a closure, and none of them work. They all rely on something. Like, you know, if you knew that hypercalor 8 folds, which were birational, had the same Dirac category, you'd probably prove it. But no one really knows that. Yeah, I mean, it's certainly true. That's one way of doing it. Well, just to take the closure, you know, we have this universal sheaf, or object, sorry, or the product. And then as we move to the closure, I want to take the limit of that. And of course, there's many different limits. If I have a stability condition, I can take the stable limit. Sorry? You're asking me what a stability condition is on the product of a K3 surface and a cubic. I refer you to Tom Bristol's talk.
No,
we don't have any.
We just don't have it, that's the problem. We just have no concept. I can't use Heisekas stability or something because this thing's not a sheaf, it's a complex of things. I've got to use Ridgeland and he's failed me. You never rely on
more questions? If not, then